the community can be reassured that our training for palliative care is increasing and improving in Tasmania, and that because all our community would like access to doctors and nurses and others who provide palliative care, whatever part of Tasmania they live in. The other areas that are really important in terms of education regarding end-of-life care are the importance of whole-person care, which is where we're looking at the care of people who are dying in terms of a holistic support, both their physical, psychological and spiritual needs, and providing doctors with a greater insight as to how to support suffering. One of the greatest fears of people when they are dying is that they will suffer intolerably or will lose control of their life, and that will diminish their dignity. And this training for our students provides them with a much greater understanding of how to understand suffering, and then also then how to support a person and also their family in that journey through suffering. At the moment, as you know, doctors are trained to save lives, to cure, and sometimes that is difficult. So, as a minimum, provide comfort and support for people when they are unwell. So that's the focus. The Hippocratic Oath says that doctors should not remove life, should not deliberately kill. And this is the basis of our ethics that we teach our medical students. Of course, the euthanasia situation, should it ever become legislation, would require doctors to provide a lethal injection or possibly physician-assisted suicide to people. That adds a whole new dimension to how doctors are trained. At the moment, it's trained to preserve life. This will require them to possibly be part of a service to terminate a person's life with a deliberate intention to do so. That whole additional option to a doctor puts them in an extremely powerful situation. They already do have often a power imbalance with patients in terms of their knowledge and their skills. And this would add an extra dimension of power to the doctor, and that's a worrying concern when often the power imbalance is distorted at the moment. It's a concern that doctors actually, or a power that doctors don't necessarily want to receive either. Most doctors are quite happy with the current situation and don't want to be put in the position of being able to provide a lethal injection to a patient. It does certainly change their relationship. There are only a small number of doctors that distribute physician-assisted suicide in Oregon. In fact, just a couple of doctors carry out large numbers, up to 10 or 15% of the whole cohort that provide that service. And the difficulty of that, of course, is that you have this referral to a small number of doctors who become experts in this area and provide almost a rubber stamp for that process of physician-assisted suicide. There are often only a very short timeline between when they meet the patient and when that service is provided, often less than a week. And that really reduces the intention of the euthanasia service, that is, of physician-assisted suicide, which was one of supposedly knowing a patient well, travelling through their dying process, and then offering that option as a last resort for someone who was extremely distressed and not able to manage their suffering in a meaningful way. This would seem to be, in Oregon, a way, however, for people to be referred to a doctor who often would specialise in this area and very rapidly provides that service without perhaps knowing that patient for a long time, and reduces the relationship between the doctor and the patient, which obviously can mitigate or prevent the need for dying in other cases. Mm-hmm. can be categorised as a group that would be vulnerable to euthanasia legislation because they may be seen as one of the categories that where their life is less important. I have, an occasion last week where I was discussing a patient who was quite unwell with an intellectual disability and required admission to hospital. And the general thought amongst the medical staff was that this person shouldn't have necessarily active treatment because their life may not be as important perhaps as other people. And that was done in a very subtle way. And so this person received palliative care for what was potentially a reversible condition. And one would feel that if euthanasia legislation was brought in, this person may have been offered an option of termination of life with a lethal injection as a possibility. And I guess that's the slippery slide we worry about. This group can be seen as being very vulnerable and they can be judged as having a life that's perhaps less than worthwhile in some people's eyes. There is an impossibility in absolutely safeguarding against euthanasia. Many jurisdictions have tried. When they do try and safeguard, often legislation becomes so convoluted and so complex that it becomes difficult to access that service or great delays in accessing the service, so it reduces its usefulness. When safeguards are applied, they're often not reported in terms of mandatory reporting, that is, the transparency reduces over time. The Netherlands is one example of that, where their reporting has become less rigorous, and there is a sense that now doctors aren't reporting many of the cases, which reduces community scrutiny of the program. We've seen or observed the playing out of the euthanasia legislation in other countries, and I guess the Netherlands is the most longest example. And here we've gone from being purely voluntary euthanasia to now involuntary euthanasia, in the sense that there are now some categories of patients, for example, young or infants that are born with a disability who fit a criteria for euthanasia, and they are certainly recommended for euthanasia without their obviously specific consent, but it goes to a committee and that committee decides on their behalf. We have in the Netherlands now this sense that patients who are finding life tiresome, are tired of life, they are now being considered for euthanasia. So it's certainly moved from that very small number of people who are distressed at the time of death, who can see no other options or solutions to their suffering, which may be a very small number in Tasmania, maybe only one or two a year, to a large, much larger number, which may include those that are just tired of living or disabled or born with a congenital problem that others deem as being life not living. So the slippery slope argument, I think, is not theoretical, but has been panned out in other jurisdictions.